Welcome to War India News Hour. Let's talk on how technology has made organizations more dependent by using facial recognition. In the midst of what is termed the fourth industrial revolution, which is changing the digital world, and face recognition is one of them. The world has seen unprecedented advances that have come together to impact everyday life like never before. The convergence of cloud computing, artificial intelligence, the Internet of Things, and many related innovations in the past 5 years have brought about profound change and disruptions to countries, industries, and the people who are part of them. In many ways, the future looks bright. A recent announcement by IBM is to stop offering facial recognition software for mass surveillance or racial profiling. It raises many questions, not sure if rest of the OEMs would follow the same. Business continuity is going to give a newer shape. Reason being, thousands of crores have been invested into the smart city projects to make the city smart, resilient and livable. And the component of the face recognition is very important to make smart cities even smarter. A typical smart city initiatives will collect data from humans, devices and assets to analyze and optimize traffic, energy efficiency, information systems and waste management. Smart city initiatives also focus on crime prevention. This is where face recognition comes in. Face recognition software is the world's most divisive technology. There were many controversies arisen over facial recognition, and its use has come up as a theory of conspiracy. By integrating facial recognition technology with a smart city initiative, it is possible to prevent crime, accelerate investigations, and ensure that public spaces are safer than ever. Let's see to the headline in War India. Microsoft releases June 2020 security patches. Microsoft has released its June 2020 batch of software security updates that patches a total of 129 newly discovered vulnerabilities affecting various versions of Windows operating systems and related products. This is the third patch announced in June 2020 with billions of users, including 11 critical vulnerabilities, all leading to remote code execution attacks, and 118 classified as important in severity, mostly leading to privilege escalation and spoofing attacks. Intel CPUs are vulnerable to new attacks. Researchers uncovered two distinct attacks that could be exploited against modern Intel processors to leak sensitive information from the CPU's trusted execution environment called SGAXE. It makes it easy for an attacker to create a ROG enclave that passes Intel's attestation mechanism, resulting in loss of security guarantees. IBM Cloud suffers global outage. The IBM Cloud is suffering a major outage, and with that, multiple services that are hosted on the platform are also down, including everybody's favorite tech news aggregator. IBM Cloud, which published a paper about ensuring zero downtime in April, also suffered a minor outage in its Dallas data center in March. IBM Cloud transfer clusters numbers to more than 20% across the globe and also listed as suffering major outages. Infosys collaborates with Celonis to offer ERP modernization services. Infosys has partnered with Munich-based company Celonis all into artificial intelligence-based business process analysis to provide its customers with enterprise resource planning, ERP systems modernization, and business process optimization, which you call BPO solutions. Food delivery via drones. Government issues new US rules. Recently, the Director General of Civil Aviation granted permission to 13 consortia, including Zomato, Swiggy, and Danjo, to test fly beyond visual line of sight VVLOS drones. The Ministry of Civil Aviation has issued draft Unmanned Aircraft Systems Rules 2020 to regulate the space. The draft issued on June 4 clearly prohibits the carriage of payload and dropping of articles by unmanned aircraft. Arun Bansal been appointed as the Executive Vice President of Ericsson. Ericsson's Board of Directors has appointed Arun Bansal as Executive Vice President. Bansal is currently Senior Vice President, Head of market area Europe and Latin America, a position he will remain in. With the appointment of Bansal, Ericsson will have two executive vice presidents, one based in Sweden and one outside the Sweden, thus providing Ericsson with great flexibility for executive vice president duties. Cipla buys stake in health tech startups GoApptiv. Cipla has agreed to pick a stake in GoApptiv Private Limited in the Indian drug market, second such bet on a digital healthcare startup since last year. Cipla said it will acquire a 21.85% stake in GoApptiv for a cash consideration of rupees 9 crore, which turns to be $1.1 million. Infibeam Avenues acquired CardPay for $1.06 million. CardPay provides a unified spend management platform to corporate under the brand name GRIT with physical and virtual credit cards, invoice processing and early payment discounting. So Infibeam acquired the CardPay technologies for $1.06 million. Salaries paid to company directors not to attract GST. The Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs on Wednesday said GST will not be levied on salaries paid to directors who are employees of the company. The CBIC issued a clarification following a ruling by the Rajasthan Authority of Advance ruling in April that said companies will have to pay GST on the remuneration they dole out to directors. Samsung Galaxy Watch 3 to launch in July. Samsung Galaxy Watch 3 is expected to have a rotating bezel design and come in a titanium variant ahead of Samsung's expected event in August. The report also says that the upcoming Galaxy Buds will be called Galaxy Buds Live. Samsung is expected to announce multiple new products at its scheduled event on August 5th. Lastly, Facebook, which has long been criticized the news publishers and spreading fake news via its social media platform, is all set to unveil its new section after it was first unveiled in October 2019 for beta testing. This improved Facebook news feature is finally rolling out to all users in the US. New section is now using the algorithms to better personalize the story selection for Facebook users. It will also be using human journalists. With this, can we say deception often inspires innovation? Look around, pay attention and imagine how the new reality will transform the world around us. Just look at the COVID watch. The number of coronavirus cases in India stands at 2,86,928 with the death toll at 8,105. The health ministry said the India's coronavirus recovery rate has reached to 48.88%. The number of recovered patients have surpassed the number of active cases in the country for the first time. With this, I would like to invite Mr. Samir Raje, Head of India, Zoom Video Communications to the News Hour. Welcome Samir to the War India News Hour. To start with, do let us know, when we talk about digital transformation, what are your observations about the acceptance by the customers?
So, I think what has happened is the COVID-19 situation has put digital transformation into a complete fast forward mode than what it was. So what was supposed to happen probably a few years down the line has started. People were forced to adopt to that today, right from work from home to, moving to the cloud-based infrastructure to, commuting the virtual world. So I think it's just gone on a fast forward mode, and we are seeing more and more adoption of these kind of technologies. It's not only the communication platform, but we will see a whole lot of plethora of other services also going digital. Right, for example, your education, for that matter. I mean, who would have thought that suddenly children would have to, study from home, and, institutes would have to offer online courses, and they would have to run schools virtually. So that suddenly they were forced to do it overnight. And that's a big change which has happened.
Nice to know this, Samir. Remote work is changing the global workspace operates, and this trend is going to continue for a longer period of time. What can you expect from Zoom?
There are two things. The large organizations, point number one, look at us as a business continuity model, where they want to ensure that their business continues even in these kind of fluid situations, if I may say, where people are not going to return to 100% strength in the offices. They'll be at max 30, 35, 25%. And this is where the business continuity proposition comes into picture. Second aspect is, from Zoom, what you can expect is the simplicity, the ease of use, and that's where the small, medium enterprises, organizations, even the home tutors or coaching classes, etc., who are struggling and want a immersive, one-touch, simple platform to use. That's where Zoom fits in ideally. So Zoom fits in at the lower end as well and the higher end as well. So it offers the best of both the worlds because of its simplicity, ease of use, and also the reporting and complexity aspects for the controllers or the ID administrators for a large organization. Mm-hmm. So we will be bringing in more and more functions and features around this, which will help people to stay connected during these difficult times.
Awesome answer. Moving forward, an important question I want to ask. What about the end-to-end encryption?
Dr. Sahu, you need to understand that when we are talking about end-to-end encryption, it is something different. Your meetings were always encrypted. It is not that Zoom never offered encrypted meetings, right? So till the time you're using a Zoom client on your desktop, laptop, or your mobile phone on tablet, the meetings are encrypted. It was always there. And they were 256-bit encrypted even before, 2 months back also.
256.
Yeah. Now we are offering 256-bit GCM encryption, which is the best of the standard available in the market, and nobody's even offering that. What we are saying is Zoom is a unified communication and collaboration platform. By that, I mean that we have to permit certain other formats of communication. You yourself, when you joined from a mobile phone. That meeting was encrypted. But what if you don't have the ability to join via an app? Let's say, for example, you just have a desk phone. You can still join a Zoom meeting using your telephone line. That is where the voice part from your device till the Zoom cloud remains unencrypted. It is not encrypted. It cannot be encrypted, right? Okay. That is the difference. Oh, however, we've gone one step ahead, acquired a company which specializes in end-to-end encryptions. And the function or what we are trying to do is we will be offering these features to some of our customers who don't want that flexibility of bringing audio conferencing or high-end video conferencing devices from meeting rooms and so on and so forth, right? That's where the difference will come in. That will be a different set of customers. As far as users like you and me are concerned, for us, this level of encryption is more than sufficient.
This is a great information for the industry to know. Lastly, what are the strategic plans that you have planned to address the newer challenges in 2020?
I'll tell you what, it's very difficult right now to say that, these will be the four challenges of 2020 because the world has turned upside down, right?
Yes.
So we have to take each day as it comes. But our primary goal is to make our product very safe and secure. So that is the reason why we are on that 90-day plan. And I think that focus will continue. With cybercrime going up by 600%, I think there is going to be hardly a day when we can take our eyes off the privacy security off the platform. It will need more and more focus on it. So that's our going to be primary goal. But having said that, as time progresses, we will also expand and try to bring in more features and functionality depend on what our customers are looking for. So obviously the COVID-19 situation has brought in new use cases. So depends what our small, medium enterprise customers come back to us and tell us what they're really looking for. And we will continue our development on that.
Thank you, Sameer, for sharing the valuable information. Thanks again for joining us in the News Hour. My key takeaway for today is China controls the global physical supply chains. It is now making a concerted bid to capture digital supply chains as well through its Digital Belt and Road initiatives. Law enforcement agencies and some companies use it to identify suspects and victims by matching photos and videos with databases like driver's license records. But civil liberties group say facial recognition contributes to privacy erosion, reinforces bias against colored people, and is prone to misuse. After IBM announcement on the facial recognition tool, traveling would no longer offer the technology, citing the potential for racial profiling and human rights abuse. Some proposals to restructure police departments call for tighter restrictions on the use of facial recognition. Experts say they believe that facial recognition is too dangerous to be used right now for law enforcement purposes. However, it does not mean the end of facial recognition. Concern arises if it is done without people's knowledge and understanding, leads to a fear into their privacy. That is it for the day, and don't forget to like, share and comment. Subscribe to War India News Magazine. Please download the War India app for the latest news and updates, which is available on Google Play Store. Stay tuned for more updates. Thank you very much. Namaskar.